About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and this evening we have a really interesting program for you. Well, I think it's interesting. We have Judy Swanson, who is our guest, and she is a Reiki master and a crystals practitioner, and she's going to explain what that is and also how she uses them with dogs. So welcome, Judy.
Thank you.
Suppose you tell me, well, we need to introduce her dog as well. This is an English toy spaniel. What's her name?
Rosebud, but known as Rosie.
Okay, this is Rosie, obviously. proper color for roses. But anyhow, she's going to demonstrate these techniques on Rosie, who is being treated right now anyway. So, suppose you tell us what Reiki is.
Reiki is a Japanese healing art.
Oh.
It puts actually uses the universal energy.
Uh-huh.
If we can relax animals or people, it goes a long way toward their healing process.
Oh, okay. Okay. What does the word actually mean? Do you know what the word itself means?
It's like God, he heals.
Oh, God heals. Okay, okay.
Or divine healing, whatever you want to use.
Yes, right, whatever your beliefs are. So now, how would this be used with dogs? She looks very relaxed, but how does this work? What do you do to help her?
It's very hands-on, and as I'm telling you about it, I'll start doing Reiki.
Okay.
It's not really anything that's going to really make, you will see, let's put it that way.
Okay.
You're trying to get all the negative energy out of an animal's body or a human's body.
Okay.
Primarily, if they have a particular health issue, some behavioral issues you can deal with Reiki as well.
Oh, okay.
You feel a lot of heat coming out of their bodies.
Uh-huh.
So you start at their heads and work toward their tails.
Okay.
As much as they will allow you to do.
Oh.
Some animals, depending on the problem they have, will not allow you to do an entire body. Some will lay there.
Yeah.
Once you learn Reiki, you feel the heat coming out.
Okay.
So you sometimes know where the problems are in their bodies.
Oh, so that's how you would find the problems, because it's hotter than the rest of the body?
At times.
Okay.
Or if I know that there's a particular problem, someone brings them to me for that particular problem,
okay,
I can work on that area.
Okay.
You always need to take their ears and go all the way out their ears, because you want to pull any negative energy off. Same with their feet. Same with their tail. As you work down the body, you're going to work through the entire body.
Okay. So what are you transferring your good energy to her, or are you just taking the bad energy away from her?
Both.
Both. Okay.
Both.
Okay.
The Reiki master's actually takes all the negative energy into their body. So when I finish, I need to get rid of that. And it's pretty much just by shaking it off of your body.
Oh,
but you need to get rid of that energy, or I would wind up sick or really tired. You will see most animals, when they have a Reiki session, are going to sleep.
Uh-huh.
They're going to drink a lot, and they're going to go to the bathroom a lot, because it's the release of all that energy that they have in their bodies.
Isn't that interesting? Now, she's small, so if you had a big dog, it would be the same
thing? I've worked on a Doberman who had, like, right behind on their front, their front leg at the top here on their back.
Uh-huh.
They had this big lump, and a gentleman brought him the dog to me and said, "What do you think is wrong?" I said, "I don't know." I said, "This is used in conjunction with veterinary medicine, not in lieu of."
Okay.
So I said to him, "You should take the dog to the vet."
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I will. So anyway, we did Reiki because the dog had a lot of problems jumping. So we were trying to calm the dog down enough that it wouldn't jump as much.
Okay.
I could only get to its neck the first session. That was it. But heat coming off of it like mad. So what I did was actually show the owner what he could do.
Yeah.
We worked on the dog. 3 weeks later, that was gone. It was actually like a Charlie horse.
Oh, my word.
So it really did. Just to relax him and work the energy, bad energy out, we were able to get rid of it.
Wow. So what did the vet say it was, or didn't he take the dog to the vet?
I think he did, but the vet wanted to do a lot of testing and things, and he just didn't want to go that route immediately. So we did this.
So then would that work like for maybe fatty tumors kind of thing?
It could. I had another person that came to me. Now, that dog was 15 years old and had a non-malignant mass. And I worked with the dog for a while. The vet eventually said the tumor was gone. Now, I'm sure it was a lot of the medicine that they were, you know, what things they were doing too.
Right, right.
But it certainly helps because it relaxes the dog. Yeah, it's wonderful to do pre and post surgery. If an animal needs surgery, it relaxes them. The healing time is much faster sometimes.
So when you're saying pre-surgery, would that be like when the dog is about to go into surgery, or would you do it a day ahead or a week ahead? Or
a lot of times a day ahead.
Okay.
Unfortunately, most vets don't think too much of the practice. So they're not all, if it's my own dog, of course they're going to let me in to do this.
Right, well,
but
they have
a lot
to,
of them, you know, they're not really thinking this is helpful. But post-surgery is if you can do it, not necessarily the same day of surgery, but when the animal comes home.
So actually, just by relaxing the dog and getting rid of the negative energy, it's actually helping the dog to heal himself.
Yes.
Okay. Well, how do they pick up this negative energy? Is it just
we all have it? It's all in. It's in the world around us. We all have negative energy. Anything that's really negative in our day-to-day work creates negative. Stress is a huge issue for all of us.
Okay.
So if we have stress in the world, we're having that negative energy. If we don't have a way to get rid of it, and most of us don't, it stays in the body and just gets worse and worse.
Oh, wow. Isn't that interesting? So then actually when you're going down her hands, you're actually pulling energy out of her feet as well.
Yes. Now she is in pretty good shape, so you don't feel a lot of heat on her because she's used to having this. But she does. We are working with. She has a slight case of mastitis.
Okay.
And she's been on a course of antibiotics and still has a little bit. So we do the Reiki every day, and when I actually do her, I can feel more heat on her stomach area where she has the problem.
So it's you know.
It is helping.
Physician heal thyself kind of thing.
It is.
That's really interesting.
It's very.
What's the matter, honey?
Very useful for people who breed dogs for whelping before the mother's going to whelp the puppies. It's good before actual breeding.
Yeah.
It relaxes the sometimes more so the female than the male.
Yeah.
But it will relax the female and she will be more receptive to breeding.
Wow.
So it has multiple uses. I use it a lot even when I'm also, people contact me to help find lost animals, and I use it a lot even with that, because it's long distance. I don't have to have the animal in my presence. I can do it long distance.
So then would you hold something of that dog?
Not necessarily. I have to have specific information. Like, I'll ask for the dog's name, the owner's name, where they live, so that I can hone in on that dog.
Okay.
And actually, because it's the universal energy that the dog puts out sometimes is very useful in helping to find lost animals.
Wow, that seems almost like impossible. Maybe it's just me, but it's like, are you sending like signals? I mean, I know the dogs have better senses. They supposedly have a sixth sense, which we technically have lost.
Exactly.
And is that what you're cueing into?
They don't block nearly as much as we always put up that barrier.
Yes.
And they don't. No animal is going to block that. It will allow any energy to come through.
Okay. So then what do you do? Just sit there and concentrate on getting where the dog is?
Yes. This summer I found a turtle in Ohio, and I was in Pennsylvania.
Oh my word!
I mean, that got out.
Oh, I was going to say, that's somebody's pet?
Yes.
I mean, it must have been gone for a while. You know, a turtle doesn't really move that fast.
Mm-hmm. It was gone about a week before they called me, and able to sit down and actually just trying to communicate with them.
Yeah.
Because it's amazing what they can. The energy that they can
tell. Well, then when you're communicating, what do you hear? Is it just the feeling of?
For me, it is.
Okay.
I just get sense. Some people say they can hear. I don't. I just get sense of that.
Okay.
And just trying to keep them calm, because when a dog is lost,
well, sure,
they get frantic.
Very upset. Sure,
so trying to send them Reiki to calm them sometimes makes it much easier.
Okay. So then, like you said, she has mastitis, and you have the antibiotic. Mm-hmm. How soon would you see results? Say, like with the Doberman. You said you worked for a couple of weeks. Is that one day a week? Is that 7 days a week?
No, with that particular animal, we did it twice a week for 3 weeks.
Okay.
It depends on the problem the animal's having.
Okay.
I get a lot of rescue animals, or would come to me more so than not. I mean, you know, because we don't know the backgrounds.
Right.
There are some animals that it would take almost an intensive every day, so 5 days a week type of situation. A lot of people think that it's one time and done, and it's not.
Yeah.
No matter what the issue is, it's just like us when we go,
for
chiropractic work or anything. It's not usually one time and that's it.
Yeah.
Most times I try to work with an animal twice a week.
Okay.
At least for a week or two.
Uh-huh.
And then prophylactically, it works great if you do it every month, once a month. Just bring them in, you know, for a half an hour session, and that worked really helpful.
So then, would it eventually, the dog would heal?
In some instances.
Or would it be an ongoing that you would have to continue? Now, obviously, with her mastitis, she's going to be cleared up.
Mm-hmm.
This is just helping as well.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
But with some animals, would it be like ongoing for the rest of their lives?
It could be. Most of the time, I try to be very honest with people.
Uh-huh.
If I don't think that it's helping, I'm going to just tell them this is not really going to help. And depending, because you have breeding issues, you know, depending how inbred they are and things, there could be, especially with a behavior issue,
people,
or the animals that have been really abused.
Abused, yeah. So now, you said behavior issues. What type of behavior issues would it be like fear or aggression, or don't you deal with aggression?
Some minor aggression issues. Some of it is separation anxiety.
Okay.
If you have a dog that has terrible separation anxiety, this is tough to deal with. I mean, even during the crystals or the Reiki.
Right.
But if you have someone with mild issues, we can deal with those.
Yeah.
And I have with many, you know, dogs and things.
Mm-hmm, that mm-hmm. So would it help, like, with if you have, like, a behavior, like with barking, you know, if the dog is constantly barking, kind of, you know, alerts to everything.
Sometimes that's when I use the essential oils as well, because some of the essential oils will calm them.
Okay.
Like your lavenders and things, you can sometimes use that, diffuse that in your, even in the home. And that really helps too.
Now, you said diffuse. That's like spraying it around?
You can spray it as a mist, or if you have, there's actually things called diffusers that you put water in and a couple drops of oil, and it diffuses like a steam almost into the air.
Okay, we'll have to
and
get it. I'm not finished with this yet. Can anybody do this? Can anybody do Reiki?
Anybody can learn it.
Okay.
It's a three-step process. There's three levels to Reiki.
Okay.
You take the Reiki 1, and then that, there's attunements to each level, which is your chakras and your whole system is opened up to different things. Reiki 1, for me, I had some abilities, but not a lot. Even Reiki 2, when I became a Reiki master, that's when it seemed to all come together.
Okay.
And you really start learning more and understanding more about just
so is this a hands-on education? Do you have to go away to a school, or where do you learn how to do this?
You can go to schools. There are schools that you can do that. Most of us find a person who is also a Reiki master that teaches.
Okay.
Some people have it for many weeks, several weeks. Some people do it in a day. And it really depends on the teacher you have. I firmly believe that you need the practice.
Okay.
Because if you just book learning is not going to teach you anything.
Yeah, I mean, hands-on, you'd have to know, you'd have to feel the heat, you'd have to touch.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is it the same with dogs as with humans? Could you do this with humans?
Do it with humans.
Oh, okay.
But one thing I need to correct is you don't actually have to put your hands on it. I could do her this way, just hands above her body.
Okay.
Same with humans. And you, when you're Reiki attuned, you will feel the heat still coming out of their body.
Okay. So then you actually are drawing the energy from her into you and then getting rid of it from you.
Correct.
Okay. It's a difficult concept.
It is. It is very difficult. Even for humans it is.
Yeah.
I mean, people...
Yeah. It's like, how does that happen? Although, you know, well, you know there's energy in the air,
mm-hmm.
obviously. You know, the sun shines, we have energy,
exactly.
You know, that kind of thing. But it just seems, it's an odd concept. So let's get back to the dog that you were only able to do the head.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get rid of the energy? Because with the paws, you were taking the energy out, and mm-hmm. as you're going down her body, you're taking the energy out her, or basically her tail. So how did you get rid of the
ears? Because I was able to do to
okay.
the first time to her neck.
Uh-huh.
We started here, and normally this is the first way I would start.
Okay.
And do this for a few minutes until I really don't think there's any heat coming out.
Okay.
I would normally work down their body and their neck, but because I could only get to that
uh-huh.
dog's neck, it was a prickier dog, so obviously its ear stood up.
Okay.
But doesn't
yeah.
matter. I would just pull the energy out, and
okay.
that dog's ears were so hot that it was amazing.
Oh, wow.
The negative energy that was coming out. The next time we were able to get maybe back to about
uh-huh,
here,
uh-huh.
and the third time I think I was able to do the entire body.
Okay.
If she was
okay.
comfortable enough to
yeah.
allow us to do that.
So then, depending on how much you practice on a dog, how long does it take from step one to being a master, step three? Or is it depending on you and how much, what's the word I want? How much energy you have in you?
To a certain extent, the energy in you, but mostly it's practice.
Okay.
It's
okay.
working. You can do Reiki on yourself. So
oh.
most of us self do Reiki every day, which
oh.
helps us as well.
Huh.
So you become more experienced. You become more adaptive. What is really the problem?
Wow. So you actually can feel the heat coming mm-hmm. out of yourself.
Mm-hmm. I have arthritis. I can tell when I hit there over the right spot with arthritis.
Wow.
And how
that
helps.
Isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. You would think everybody would want to do that.
You would.
Okay, let's go into the essential oils now.
Okay.
What kind of oils are we talking about when you're saying essential oils, other than lavender?
I use lavender, geranium, heliochrysum is a great healer, frankincense is a great healer.
Oh.
So any of those. Now, with dogs, dogs and horses are a lot easier to use oils on.
Okay.
Cats are you have to be very careful what oils you use on
okay.
felines.
Okay.
But even some oils, they call them hot oils, so you want to dilute those with another, like a vegetable oil or something before you put it on.
Okay.
But with her, I use lavender right on her
uh-huh,
stomach
uh-huh.
for her mastitis.
Yeah.
And just put it in that little area, and that's working well.
Yeah, so it's the pure oil that you're using? What
therapeutic grade. Mm-hmm.
What do you put it on your hand to rub it in? Mm-hmm. Or
I do. I put it, for her, in her instance, I just put it on my finger.
Okay.
Most of the times when dogs come to me for Reiki, before they come, I will use lavender, put a few drops on my hands, rub my hands together so that
yeah.
it's exuding
yes.
this calming
right,
influence
already.
From the time
yeah,
when they
yeah.
come in.
Yeah, and obviously lavender is very relaxing,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
because people use it at bedtime to, you know,
exactly.
put on the pillow or whatever.
Exactly.
So what are some of the other, I'm assuming you would use different oils for different problems.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And it's very much, I have a manual at home that's actually was written by a vet. Who
okay.
uses a lot of essential oil. So
okay.
if someone comes with a problem I'm not maybe as familiar with,
uh-huh, uh-huh.
I will go to that and see what oils they suggest to
okay.
use.
Okay.
Sometimes it's a mixture. You
uh-oh.
Use more than one. Sometimes
okay.
it's these single oils will work very
yeah.
well.
Yeah. So what would you use? What would you use them on? Other than the lavender, what would you use some of the other ones for?
With her mastitis, I could use geranium.
Okay.
I could use heliochrysum.
So geranium is just healing like the lavender?
Mm-hmm. They're all essential and they all have...
like different properties?
They all have properties just like the crystals do.
Okay.
Everything has properties and sometimes you can use the same oil for multiple uses.
Okay.
It just is what
okay.
works best for each one of us.
Uh-huh.
Some
oh,
things work better
okay.
than others.
All right. So now, can you buy essential oils just any old place?
You can. You probably are not going to get therapeutic grade,
okay.
which is a much purer product.
Okay.
Those are more difficult to find.
Okay.
You, if you go to a drugstore and things, you're usually finding things that are great for diffusing, but not necessarily would work as well.
Okay.
On this.
Oh my goodness, we only have 5 minutes left. We didn't even get into the crystals. Now, what are you using the crystals for?
Crystals are great, again, for animals or humans that have issues. This is
amethyst.
This is amethyst. Okay. Amethyst is very good for using if you have, a lot of people use this for arthritis.
Okay.
A lot of people, this is a great healing stone. This is rose quartz, which is it's known as the basic healer. This is usually I have all the time. I brought the larger crystal just for ease of seeing.
Yes.
This is clear quartz, excuse me, which magnifies whatever other product whatever other crystal you're putting it with.
Oh, so you'd use the two of these together?
You
then?
Could. So
the
clear quartz will magnify any of the properties in the amethyst.
Huh.
This I brought along just because this is how a lot of people buy them. You just need a small
piece.
Small piece. Yeah. This is rose quartz. A lot of people buy these either to wear on necklaces themselves or to put on a dog's leash.
Okay.
This is blue lace agate, and this is very good again for arthritis properties with animals.
And what's the colored
this
one?
Is aragonite. And this is also very good for that. A lot of times people will say, well, how do I deal with these with animals?
Yeah.
If they sleep in crates, I put them outside of the crate. Obviously, you don't want them chewing on them.
Okay.
If they sleep in your bed with you, put them on your nightstand because it's going to help you and the animal, which is
so
where I have mine.
That it's in close proximity to them.
Yes.
It doesn't need to be touching
them. Does not need to be touching them.
Wow.
I mean, there are times when I will take it and actually put it on an animal.
Yeah.
But more so than not, I just let it out there. And
because
the properties, even as they sit here, we are absorbing their properties.
Yeah. So this would work well for, like, anxiety?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
You just hang it on their leash and or their collar?
You can.
Well, could you use a couple of different ones?
You can. I have some people who have 5 or 6.
Oh, my
that
word.
Are just hanging from their animals.
Yeah.
Or used with their animals, yes.
So then actually, if you're wearing a stone ring, it would actually, like if I wore an amethyst ring, it would help me?
Mm-hmm. It would. Because there's still properties coming off of this.
Yeah.
And they come in different forms. This is what they call is natural cut.
Okay.
These, because they're shiny, are tumbled stones, they call them.
Right.
There's really no difference. It's just preference, whatever you like. And so these small ones, in my pocket right now, I have carnelian and the clear quartz because I have arthritis. And carnelian works very well for me, better than amethyst.
Okay.
So I carry those in all the time.
All I knew of amethyst was that it was serenity. It was the serenity stone. I don't know why I remember that. Maybe because I needed all the serenity I can get. Quite sure. It is my birthstone. Amethyst is my birthstone. So, of course, what am I wearing? A sapphire, you know? What can I say? That's really interesting. So then, where would you get something like this?
Again, I have them in my store. There's places you can
buy
them.
Oh, you have a store?
I have a store.
Okay.
In Pottstown, yep.
Okay, so then you'd be able to get all of this junk.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Including the essential oils.
Yes.
How about that? And you'd have these pretty little things, too?
I do.
Wow, they're nice. That's great. So then you actually have to get educated with this as well.
So it's
an ongoing education between the Reiki and the stones and, the crystals and the essential oils. It's everything is sort of like all together. You can use all of them to help your dog.
You can.
Or you. Mm-hmm. Wow, that's really interesting. So that's in Pottstown then?
It is.
You're in Pottstown.
I am.
Right in downtown?
No, closer to the Coventry Mall.
Okay. Well, that's close too.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay, well, I guess I covered everything that I needed to cover, which is good. Okay, so I guess that's our program for this evening.
Thank you
so much, Judy, and I'm sure I'll be visiting you down in Boston.
Thank you for having me.
So that's our program for this evening, and next month we'll be talking about our mat show. So come back, visit with us next month for this evening. Good night.
About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.